Hey, what's up, and welcome to the church at Lake Forest. My name is Chris Sykes. I get to be one of the pastors here at the church, and I'm so glad that you are joining us online this morning. Listen, if you're one of our guests, if we haven't met you in person, if you're watching online for the first time, or maybe you just haven't connected with us, what we would love for you to do is take out your phone and simply text the word guest, G-U-E-S-T, guest, to 662-709-6849. You're going to get a response with a link, and we'd just love to be able to text you, to email you, to let you know what's going on, and we would love to invite you to come join us in person at the church at Lake Forest. We are meeting in person every week, just about every week, unless we have to shut down for one reason or another. We're meeting at the church every week at 10 a.m., so you're invited to join us there. As a matter of fact, next week would be a great week to come because it is our annual family Christmas breakfast. Now, we've been doing this for years and years and years. I mean, since I was a teenager, we've had this breakfast at our church. And so what we'll do is next Sunday morning at 10 a.m., if you're coming, just, you know, bring a dish, bring a breakfast casserole, bring some, you know, biscuits and sausage, or, you know, whatever you want to bring. Just bring a breakfast dish. We'll have the drinks, we'll have the plates, we'll have everything, and we'll spread out as much as we can. We'll start with breakfast, and then, of course, we'll worship our children's ministry leaders. They'll have a story for our kids. We'll all be together as one big happy family, and we'll enjoy and celebrate Christmas together with our annual family Christmas breakfast, and, of course, a time for worship and the Word. And then, of course, on Christmas Eve, December 24th, we will meet at 5 o'clock for our annual Christmas Eve service, Christmas on the Bluff. We'd love for you to invite your friends. Come join us. Make this your family tradition every single year, where on Christmas Eve, you bring friends and family, you start at the church, and then, you know, end at your house for your Christmas Eve party. Whatever it is that you normally do for Christmas Eve, include worshiping God in that. I promise you it'll be a great time. Again, we'll be together for a family service in the auditorium. We will have childcare for our youngest ones, those who are nursery age. But otherwise, you know, preschool and up, we'll all be together for a great family service on Christmas Eve. And then one last thing, and that is the Sunday after Christmas, for a variety of reasons I won't get into now, we're going to be online only on that Sunday. So we will not meet in person at 10 a.m. on Sunday, December 27th. We'll be online only. All right. I'll tell you what, let me pray for us, and then we're going to jump into God's Word for week 3 of Counting on Christmas this week. Dear Heavenly Father God, we love you. God, we praise you. We want to just let the world know this season who you are. That Jesus came to live and to die and to come back to life, to pay the penalty for our sins, to save us, and God, to love us. We are a place where no perfect people are allowed because, God, none of us are perfect in your sight. But you make us holy. God, in your grace and in your mercy and in your love for us, you sent your Son, whose blood was shed to cover over all of our sins. And so, God, we worship you this morning for that. Jesus, we thank you and praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
I was there that very first Christmas night. I was the one who delivered the message to Mary that she would have a son. At that time, I didn't understand the great miracles that were to follow this child. I watched from heaven when Mary and Joseph were left outside the inn, and the King of Kings was left to be born in the most humble of places. He deserved the best, but he slept next to the animals. Then there was the star. The star that God placed at the beginning of time for it to sit above the king like a crown. And when he had finally come, he was perfect. Born to love, heal, and forgive, but born to one day die. But death is no match for the precious Son of God who put on flesh for it to be battered and broken. Because of him, sin would be conquered and the curtain between God and man would forever be torn.
So, you can think of Christmas as that peaceful nativity scene on top of your mantle, but I like to think of it as the night that heaven found its victory, when sin no longer had power, and when our mighty King began his reign above all. That Christmas wasn't much of a silent night, because we were cheering and dancing and telling everyone that Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, was born.
Story, God, you entered in and became
All right. So I've got a question for you this morning. Have you ever lost control? And I don't mean lost control, lost your temper, that sort of thing. I mean like lost control where you were involved in something and you thought, you know, everything was safe and everything was okay, and all of a sudden, you know, just this things go haywire and you lose control. Happened to me a few years ago, actually several years ago. It's been well over 20 years now, because Stephanie and I, we were still dating at the time. We weren't married yet. But we were going down to Jackson, Mississippi to visit some of her family. And it was a cold, cold winter day. If I remember right, it had been snowing a little bit, maybe even sleeting, but not at the moment. However, when we got into Jackson, there was ice on the highway. And so I didn't see it. I hit a patch of black ice. And man, I lost control. We started sliding. I wasn't going very fast. But I could not, you know, I couldn't straighten the car back up, and we just sort of slowly drifted over toward the median, and we hit the median, and the angle that we hit it, it sort of spun us around, and then bam, the back end hit, we bounced off the median, and I said, Stephanie, I think we're going to hit it again, and we came back around, and I mean, we hit that thing two or three times. And it was crazy. I think at one point I actually just took my hands off the wheel because there was nothing I could do. We were basically ice skating, right? We were okay. We weren't going fast. It didn't do a whole lot of damage to the car. I was able to fix most of it, you know, myself. But in that moment, I was not in control. Nature was. And I got to be honest with you, that bothers me, right? I want to be in control. Obviously, when I'm behind the wheel of a car, I want to be in control of that car. I want to be in control of my life. Sometimes I want to take control so much that I want to take control from God. And the problem happens is when we want to control our lives and not allow God and His will, and His mercy, and His grace, and His plans, and His purposes take control, that we don't submit ourselves to Him. Well, this Christmas, we're doing this series called Counting on Christmas, and Luke records the story of a young woman. We're going to be back in Luke chapter 1. You know her as Mary, the mother of Jesus. And what I admire so much about Mary is that things are completely out of her control for a moment. You know, this birth is not something that she has planned for. It's frankly something that she's probably going to get a lot of grief over in the moment. She may lose her future husband. She doesn't. Joseph does marry her. But there's so many things that in a moment are completely out of her control. And yet she still submits herself to God because she knows that she can count on God. And what I find amazing is that God in His sovereignty has chosen to count on humanity. That in our Christmas story, God chose to count on Mary and Joseph. And you know, even today, God still chooses to count on us. I want you to understand, He does not need us to fulfill His will, but He chooses to count on us. That is something that is amazing. So we're going to look at this story from Mary, and before we jump into it, let me clear up a couple of things. First of all, there are some faith traditions who would overemphasize the importance of Mary. She gets, in some cases, more attention than Jesus. That she is often called Mary, the mother of God, and probably a worse name than that is that she's often referred to as a co-redeemer. I want you to understand, Mary's a great woman. She's a faithful young lady. She's basically a clueless teenager when we begin to read about her in Luke chapter 1, but she is faithful to God. However, there is no redeeming power in Mary because Mary is still a sinner just like the rest of us. God simply showed favor on Mary and chose to use Mary in a way that, frankly, He could choose to use any of us to fulfill His will. So we have to be careful not to overemphasize Mary. At the same time, there are some that would underemphasize Mary. And I think a lot of that has to do with just a gut reaction to those who would overemphasize Mary. And so some would underemphasize her role. Understand, again, she's a godly mother, right? She is someone who cares for Jesus, who guides him as a boy, who still has a voice to speak into his life and to speak into our lives. So it is like any man or woman in the Bible that we would read about, any great hero of the faith, Mary is still someone that we should read and study about and learn what it was about Mary that, quite frankly, caused God to choose her and use her to fulfill his will. And so that's what we're going to do this morning. Because I'm amazed at a teenager. I mean, she's a young teenage girl when the angel shows up, who is so ready to go on an adventure with God. It just amazes me. So open your Bibles to Luke chapter 1. We've been in Luke chapter 1 for the last couple of weeks. We're going to be in Luke chapter 1 again this week, starting in verse 26. And I'm just going to read the whole story here from 26 to 56. So here's what it says. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. All right, now remember, Elizabeth is, we've talked about Elizabeth and Zechariah for the last couple of weeks. She is the mother of John the Baptist, or is about to be the mother of John the Baptist. She's older. She's stricken in her years, is the way that Zechariah describes he and his wife. And God has performed a miracle in her life that she's going to give birth to the man, John, who will herald in the Messiah, Jesus. And so she's in the sixth month of her pregnancy. God sent an angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Verse 34, Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I am a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." I think you should underline that verse, right? That should be one that we all memorize. "For the word of God will never fail." Verse 38, Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. A few days later, Mary hurried to the hill country of Judea, to the town where Zechariah lived. She entered the house and greeted Elizabeth. At the sound of Mary's greeting, Elizabeth's child leapt within her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Elizabeth gave a glad cry and exclaimed to Mary, "God has blessed you above all women, and your child is blessed. Why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me? When I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. You are blessed because you believed that the Lord would do what he said." Verse 46, Mary sings what is now called the Magnificat. This is a song from Mary. Mary responded, "Oh, how my soul praises the Lord, how my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he took notice of his lowly servant girl, and from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One is holy, and he has done great things for me. He shows mercy from generation to generation to all who fear him. His mighty arm has done tremendous things. He has scattered the proud and haughty ones. He has brought down princes from their thrones and exalted the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away with empty hands. He has helped his servant Israel and remembered to be merciful, for he made this promise to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever. Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months and then went back to her own home. So what I want to talk to you about this morning is how God uses his holy instruments. Because the reality is, like I said earlier, God has chosen in his sovereignty to use us, to count on us. Back in the very beginning, when you know, in the Old Testament, when God made his first covenant with Abraham, and God has renewed that covenant repeatedly with the people of Israel, and then you know, we've come into the New Testament with the new covenant through Jesus Christ, but God continues to complete and keep the promises, complete those covenants, even as he renews his covenant with his chosen people, because we are the children of God, because we have been chosen by God. What God said in the beginning and what God says to us is that you will be my people and I will be your God and you will be holy just as I am holy. If you have trusted Jesus as your Savior, you are a child of God. You are holy. That word holy means to be set apart, something that is used for a special purpose. You are a holy instrument of God. Mary was chosen to be a holy instrument of God. The amazing thing about Mary and the amazing thing about us is that God chooses us. In his grace, in his sovereignty, in his mercy, God can use any of us. God can use any of us, but we see some patterns in Scripture, and we see this the same pattern in the life of Mary, where God typically chooses people that he can count on, and he chooses to count on them. Not that they're perfect, but that there is a certain faithfulness, a certain righteousness in their lives, because they've been following along with God. Their hearts are attuned to his purposes. And so God gives them a special purpose because it matches his purpose and their heart is aligned with his heart. And so I want to point out to you simply four things about the way that God counts on us that we learn from this passage and that we learn from the life of Mary. Some questions for us to ask ourselves and sort of comparing ourselves to this heroine in the Bible who is simply amazing. So the first thing that I would point out, number one, is God counts on people only by his grace. God counts on people only by his grace. Going back to verse 28, when Gabriel appeared to Mary, he said, "Greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you." He calls her favored. And then down in verse 30, he says, "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God." A couple of times, the angel refers to Mary as being favored. This word favored, your translation may even say highly favored, because this word favored, it comes from the same root that the word grace comes from. And it in Greek, and it really means highly favored, that only by the free grace of God was Mary chosen for God to show favor on her. That it wasn't something that Mary did. Now, Mary lived a righteous life, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but that God, in his love, in his sovereignty, in his mercy, in his grace, that anytime we receive the grace of God, it is a free gift. And so, you know, Mary didn't go to God and ask God, "God, you know, give me this special purpose in life," right? And I'm not saying that she didn't often pray to God and say, "God, show me the purposes that you have for my life." But in this case, God has freely chosen Mary through his grace to show favor on her and to use her. It's his gracious choosing of an instrument, because Mary was a sinner saved by the grace of God, just like we are. 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, "We have this treasure," or the gospel in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. In other words, the gospel is part of God's grace. It's not by anything that we do. It's a free gift so that no man can boast in it. Listen, God has chosen us, his earthly vessels, to bring the grace of God to the world, just like he chose Mary. When we testify of God's grace, we're giving him the glory, and we're letting people see him work through us, that he is preeminent, and it's not about us. That's what Mary does. She makes it about God and not about her. Even though she is favored, the favor comes from God. So number two, I would say that God counts on his people in his own power. God counts on people in his own power. Notice this is always about him. It's not about me, God. It's all about you. In verse 35, it says, the angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you." And then down in verse 37, it says, "For the word of God will never fail." Right, so Mary asks how this miraculous birth of Jesus is supposed to occur. I mean, it's a natural question. So you're saying I'm going to get pregnant, but I'm not married yet, and we're doing the right thing, and we're making the right decisions. So how is this going to happen, right? How am I going to have this virgin birth? And the angel gives her, you know, God's answer, and it's pretty clear. The Holy Ghost is going to accomplish it supernaturally. The power of God is going to overcome the laws of nature. God is able to do that. It's called a miracle when the supernatural invades the natural. And the world will testify of God's power, that that's what's going to happen through the birth of Jesus Christ. Then the messenger gives Mary the testimony of what has happened in Elizabeth's life. He lets her know, hey, by the way, your cousin Elizabeth, God's also working a miracle in her life. She too has experienced the power of God. So Mary is experiencing the power of God in her life. Listen, when you align yourself with the purposes of God and God chooses you to fulfill his purposes, he will empower you to be able to do that. He counts on his people in his own power. If you're wondering how it is that God is supposed to use you, just remember what he said to his disciples in John 15, 5. He said, "I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." I think if Jesus were telling that same story today and using that same line today in a modern culture, he would say, "You are the computer, I am the power outlet. If you keep plugged into me, you'll be able to accomplish many things," right? You'll be able to go everywhere you want to go and spread the gospel through the world on the internet through the power of video. But you got to stay plugged in to me. I will give you power, right? That's what he's saying to the disciples. That's what he's saying to us. Mary was already plugged into God, and God continued to empower her through the power of the Holy Spirit. Again, if you align your heart with the purposes of God and God chooses you to fulfill his purposes, he will empower you to do that. We don't have to be afraid. Just like the angel said to Mary, don't be afraid. And then I got to go back, you know, one more time to that verse 37. For the word of God will never fail. The word of God will never fail. Listen, if you want to be empowered to do the will of God and fulfill the purposes of God, you need to become a warrior, like I'm a fighter. We need to become a warrior of the word. We need to become warriors of the word, because the word of God will never fail. If you want failure to flop in your life, then flip open the word of God. If you want to stop failing at life, do life with Jesus. Dig into God's word. He will help you make better decisions in your life, because when you apply the word of God to your life, it will never fail. And if that's what's supporting you, guess what? You won't fail either. Every time. It works every time when we base our life on the word of God. Number three, God counts on people for his purpose. God counts on people for his purpose. God used Mary to birth Jesus to save others. That was one of the purposes of God. Verse 31, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. God always has his own reasons for using his people to fulfill his purposes. And sometimes he doesn't even tell us what those reasons are. In this case, he made it clear to Mary, this is why this is happening. This is what's going to come of this. Sometimes we don't get that on the front end. Sometimes we don't understand God's purpose until after the act, the deed is done, until after we choose to follow him, when we take a step of faith, then we understand the purposes. I think for Mary, this was so huge. This was such a big deal. I mean, this is the biggest deal that's ever happened in the history of the universe. You know, creation, fall, Jesus, right? And not really in that order. Jesus is still the most important. But I think it was so big that God let her know his purposes. But he also used Mary so that he would receive the glory. And so we read in verses 46 through 56 that Magnificat of Mary, that she gives God the glory. When I read it the first time, I tried to emphasize a little bit the word he, because for the first couple of verses, you know, she basically praises God for what he has done in her life. And then for the rest of it, she praises God for what he has done for the people of Israel. But she says, "Oh, how my soul praises the Lord." Notice what her focus is on. Her focus is not on her problems. It's not on her circumstances. It's not even on her son. At this point, it's on her Lord, her God, which, of course, is God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is her son. But she's praising God. "How my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Mary, did you know? Yes. Yes, she knew. And so did Elizabeth. Elizabeth, when she sees Mary, the Bible says that her baby leaps inside of her and that she's filled with the Holy Spirit. And she says, you know, "How am I so blessed that I get to stand in the presence of my Lord in your belly?" Right? Even Elizabeth knows. So yes, yes, Mary knew. But she says, "The mighty one is holy. He has done great things. He shows mercy. His mighty arm. He has brought down princes. He has filled the hungry with good things. He has sent the rich away. He has helped Israel. He has remembered to be merciful. He has made his promises to our ancestors," right? Everything is about God. God counts on his people for his purposes. Listen, if you're in a place in your life right now where you're like, "Man, God, I just wish God would use me for something amazing," continue being faithful like Zechariah and Elizabeth and Mary. But make sure that you don't want God to use you just so that you can be famous, right? Like, "Man, I want a story like that person has because I want to be able to write a book. I used to think this way as a children's minister, as a pastor. Man, I just want a platform so that, you know, everybody will read my blog and that one day I'll write a book and everybody will read my book and I'll have all these followers." And it became at a point really all about me. And I had to realize it's not about me and my platform and how many people, you know who I am. It's about Jesus. It is about Jesus and his purposes. Let's align our hearts, our spirits, with the Spirit of God, with the heart of God. Let's align our purposes with his purposes, and then he will count on us. He can count on us, and he will choose us to fulfill his purposes. When you align your heart with the purposes of God, God empowers you through his power, not your power. God empowers you through his power to accomplish his purposes. And then finally, number four, God counts on people who are available. God counts on people who are available. Verse 38, Mary responded to the angel, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And then the angel left her. I mean, Mary's instant response, instant obedience. It wasn't like, "Well, angel, you know, let me go pray about this, right? I'm going to put a fleece out before God and if, you know, it's wet on..." No, no, no. This was instant obedience, instant faith from Mary. She instantly made herself available to say yes. I mean, I don't know what would have happened if she would have said no. God had already chosen her. I'm sure she would have still gotten pregnant. It would have been miserable for her. But she didn't. So we don't really know. I mean, all we can do is speculate. But instead, she said yes. She was instantly available. She was already being faithful before. And so when God gave her an assignment, He could count on her. And remember, I'm not saying that God needs us. He does not need us because He's a sovereign God, but He chooses us in His sovereignty to fulfill His purposes. And so God could count on Mary because she'd already been faithful and He knew she was going to be faithful. She made herself available. She was already living a faith-filled life, and she was going to be faithful to His purposes. Now, this passage in the Greek points out three times that Mary is a virgin. And I think there's a couple of reasons for this. One on the theological side is to point out the impeccability of God birthing Jesus, that it's through the power of the Holy Spirit, that Jesus is divine, that He is the Son of God. But there's also a practical side. It lets us know that Mary was ready for her assignment, that she had continued to be faithful and faith-filled to God. What I find interesting is that exact same word describing Mary as a virgin is also used figuratively in 2 Corinthians and in Revelation to describe believers who were pure and faithful to Christ, their Heavenly Father. Listen, as a Christian, whether you're married, divorced, single, whatever, whether you are a physical virgin or not, you can be a spiritual virgin to God. It's when you remain faithful to our bridegroom, to Christ Jesus. Listen, God chooses the faith-filled and the faithful. Let's be faith-filled to God. Now, you might even be asking, so how can I grow my faith? I mean, Mary seems to be an amazingly faith-filled and faithful person. Zechariah and Elizabeth that we've talked about for the last 2 weeks, they were amazingly faithful people. For their entire lives, it seems that they have been faith-filled and faithful to the purposes of God and waited and waited and waited, and then God finally used them. How can I grow my faith to be like them? I'm glad you asked that question, because the disciples asked the same question of Jesus. In Luke chapter 17, in verse 5, the apostles said to the Lord, "Show us how to increase our faith." And then there's this famous response from Jesus. You've probably heard it before. And He talks about them having faith the size of a mustard seed. He says, "If you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'May you be uprooted and be planted in the sea,' and it would obey you." Now, a lot of times we read that passage, and I think what we imagine in our minds is that these disciples, that they've got no faith, that God's saying, "Man, you just need a little bit of faith, and you've got no faith. Like, what's wrong with you guys?" So they've left their families, they've left their businesses, they've been following after Jesus. They followed after Jesus for, three and a half years. They're men of faith. I think what Jesus is saying to these guys is, guys, you've got faith. I think what Jesus is saying to you today is that you've got faith, but what you need to understand is another concept. What He's saying is, guys, you've got faith, but if you only had the faith of a mustard seed, you could accomplish so much. You've got more faith than you need. If you've trusted Jesus as your Savior to forgive you of your sins, you've got more than enough faith to accomplish the purposes of God. Because if you just had a little, like the tiniest bit of faith, you could tell that tree to go plant itself in the ocean, and that's exactly where it would go. Because here's what Jesus says after that, and this is a hard passage for us in 21st century United States of America to understand. But in verse 7, He goes on to say, "When a servant comes in from plowing or taking care of sheep, does his master say, 'Come in and eat with me'?" So this is a master-servant relationship, right? Think master-slave. You can use the word servant, use the word slave. It doesn't matter. really in the context, that this is a master servant. So there's someone who is under the authority of his master. Whatever the master says, he must do. Okay? So the servant's been out plowing the field, taking care of the sheep. He's been out, you know, doing the work that he would do during the day. And so the question is asked, when he comes back into the house, does the master say to the servant, hey, come sit down at the dinner table with me. Let's enjoy a meal together. Verse 8, no. He says, prepare my meal, put on your apron, and serve me while I eat. Then you can eat later. And then, does the master thank the servant for doing what he was told to do? Of course not. In the same way, when you obey me, you should say, we are unworthy servants who have simply done our duty. Man, we read that today and we think, Jesus, how was he not just, or how? Why was he so full of pride? Well, first of all, he's God, right? So he's the only one who could legitimately say that. But secondly, his audience would completely understand what he's talking about, this master-servant relationship. It makes perfect sense to them that, of course, a master is not going to invite the servant to come to the table with him. It's just not what happens. If you're a servant, after you've done work out in the field, your expectation is to come in and do the work in the home that needs to be done to prepare the meal and serve the master, and then you get to eat and go to bed. That's the relationship here. I don't want you to focus so much on those details, so much as the principle that Jesus is teaching to them. What Jesus is teaching to the disciples is obedience. In other words, if you have a small amount of faith, you've got, I don't know how much faith you've got, let's say you've got this much faith, but if you took just a little pinch of faith, instead of asking me how to grow your faith, what I'm saying to you is you've got enough faith. Now you need to use it in obedience. That guys, if you would just learn to obey me, that little bit of faith, like you could tell that tree to go jump in the lake and it'd go jump in the lake. We need to not grow our faith by just like praying, God, would you grow my faith? But we grow our faith and we walk in the purposes of God when we begin to practice obedience. If you want great faith, practice great obedience. If you want instant faith, practice like Mary did, instant obedience. And if you want questionable faith, then practice questionable obedience. What we see in the life of Mary, what we see in the life of the disciples, what we see in so many biblical heroes. I mean, we could talk about David, we could talk about Elijah, we could talk about Moses, we could talk about Paul, we could talk about Matthew, we could talk about so many people that we herald as great, amazing men and women of faith, and they were. The difference maybe between them and us is not the amount of faith in their lives, but how often they said yes. How often they've made themselves available because they will obey instantly, emphatically, in a great way, they will obey what God has told them to do. So this Christmas, God can choose you, and maybe God will choose you because you can be counted on. This Christmas season, Satan, our enemy, will attack you because you can be counted on. But my question this morning is, will the world worship Jesus? Will the world around you, your family, your friends, your coworkers, the person checking you out at Walmart, will the world around you come to know and love and worship Jesus because you can be counted on? That's my prayer for you. My prayer for you is that like Mary, like Zechariah, like Elizabeth, that your heart will be aligned to the purposes of God and that God will use you to accomplish his purposes. He will empower you. He will choose you. He will choose the purpose, but you must choose to obey, to make yourself available to God. Make yourself available to God this Christmas season so that he counts on you and so does the rest of the world. Let's live faith-filled and faithful lives. Let me pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we love you. God, thank you for loving us. God, thank you for calling us. Thank you for using us. God, we simply pray this morning to be reminded to commit ourselves to your purposes, to be reminded each and every day that, God, you can and will use us, but we have to make ourselves available to you. God, thank you for calling us. Thank you in your sovereignty for choosing to count on us, for empowering us for your purposes. And God, help us. Help us with each step of our faith to obey you, to make ourselves more and more available to you so that we can see amazing things happen through us, through our church, in our community, so that we will become a church that truly is for our neighbors and the next generation. Jesus, we love you, we thank you and praise you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.